Hey folks, Kilt-Man here. Kilt-Man at your vampiric services. How are you all? Hope you're all doing very, very well. Now, here's the review of Gary Dauberman's remake, readaptation of Stephen King's Salem's Lot. Talked about it a lot. I've talked about it, Salem's Lot on the channel. Long delayed. COVID, then getting shelved by Warners, then getting shunted from one release date to another, then, oh, it's going straight to streaming, but we don't know when. Then they give it a date, October the 3rd, which came and went. October the 3rd for the US on Max. In the UK, we didn't get it. No, we didn't. It doesn't open here till the 11th of October. And get this, theatrically, only theatrically, and in Ireland as well, I think. So, in the last video I said, fuck that. No one's telling me what I can and can't see when I want to see it. Having reported on this so many times in the past, I thought, no, screw it. I will use illicit means. Yes, and I don't advocate doing this a lot, but sometimes when need be. Funnily enough, with another vampire movie, The Last Voyage of the Demeter, I had to do the same thing. I had to find somewhere that was streaming it so I could watch it and review it, because we were never going to get it any other way. And that was a big disappointment. But anyway, so I watched Salem's Lot, Gary Dauberman, 2024 release. And in perfect HD quality and damn good sound as well. Which was apt because it looks and sounds great as well. So those of you in the UK thinking, I might do this, I might go to the cinema to watch this, it actually probably will look and sound pretty good. However, there is a film therein to consider. Massive fan of Salem's Lot, huge fan of Tobe Hooper's 79 version. Oh God, look, I'm not gonna go over all this again. You know all the basics and my love and infatuation with all things vampiric and Kurt Barlow. Kurt Barlow, especially as renditioned, characterised by Reginalda, which you get in this movie. So, folks, spoilers are ahead. Ben Mears, American author, heads back to his hometown of Jerusalem's Lot, if you're a local, Salem's Lot, where he left at the age of 9 after his parents were killed in a horrific car crash, and he went to live with an extended family in New York, I think, and comes back to sort of find some inspiration for a new novel. But when he gets there, yeah, there's other arrivals in town. There's Mr. Straker and his business partner, Mr. Kurt Barlow, who have an antique store and have now taken over residency of the old Marston House on the hill. The haunted Marston House, the former dwelling place of a mafia hitman who turned to Satanism. And Ben Mears is transfixed by that place. He meets other people, other residents of the town, strikes up a romance, gets some other bonds of friendship going. And then they discover that people are going missing. But those people that go missing tend to come back and put the bite on people, because yes, they are a vampire. So Kurt Barlow is an ancient vampire who has taken Salem's Lot. This is my new nesting ground. This is going to be my new empire. And we are told in the movie that, like, he wants to transform the town into his own image. Yeah, okay, right. So, we have a beleaguered ragtag, it's always that term, ragtag group of vampire hunters, headed up by Ben Mears, Susan Norton, his love interest, a teacher, a priest, and a plucky young kid, you know, who is a monster kid. He's a devotee of universal horror monsters and all that. And Hammer. If we have a little cursory view around his bedroom, well, we'll come on to that later. All the little knickknacks and things that are in there. He's one of us, folks. He's one of us. And a trusty doctor, Dr. Cody. Now, these are all characters from Stephen King's original novel, and they were all in the 79 version, and then the Rob Lowe, Rutger Hauer version in 2004-2003, both of which were TV miniseries, so literally two episodes, an hour and a half long each, and that's kind of what you need to fully tell the story of Stephen King's quite extensive and sop operatic, and full of subtext, backstories, and convoluted interplay. A lot of shit you don't need, really, but it does bring the characters to life. And TV miniseries kind of allows characters to grow. This movie is shy of 2 hours. I remember like thinking at the time, when I first reported on this, there's no fucking way they can do this any justice. And then I began to think, once the trailer dropped, and I thought, that I've done videos on all this, I thought, that trailer looks great. The cinematography looks brilliant. There's some great transitions there, scene transitions. I thought, that looks pretty good. I like the mood, I like the atmosphere. This could sodding well work. As a cut-to-the-bones, streamlined version of what King wrote, an adaptation without all the waffle that he brings into his books. Could work. So did it? Did it work? Well, okay, folks, right. Cheers, y'all. I'm playing the score to the original 79 version of Tobe Hooper from Harry Suckman. I have the score to the new version by Nathan Barr and Lisbeth Scott, I think it is. Lisbeth Scott, yeah. And it's a good score as well, although it does take in a bit of Roque Banos' score for Evil Dead, the Evil Dead remake, and kind of does plagiarise that quite a little bit when you listen to it a bit more. But it's a good score though, I'll be honest. But again, more on that later. I play it now, but those of you in the know that I can't, because we don't have the play system, the playlist at my beck and call. I have the score on Amazon, yeah. Ordinarily, I transfer that onto the PC, and I'd be playing it for you now. No, I can't. So, we're stuck with the vintage stuff, which is better on all counts. Aye. So, yeah, there'll be spoilers ahead. Playing Ben Mears, you have Bill Pullman's son. Is it Lee? Lewis Pullman. With kind of greasy hair, and he's playing the hero main character in the most blandest of fashions. Now, maybe that's a hallmark of a great actor, that, look, I want to play him bland. Well, he does. He's bland as they come. In fact, he's boring, and for a good third of the movie, he's just disappeared into the ether. Whilst other things take place in Salem's Lot, kids go missing, then come back, scratchy at windows. You've got all that. All your favourite scenes from Salem's Lot are here. And none of them are as good. They're not, I'll be honest. For the first half of this movie, I actually really, really enjoyed it. It has so many great points. The cinematography, again, is outstanding. It is by... See if I did write this down somewhere. Cinematography. Michael Burgess, is it? Burgess? It's wonderful. What I will say is that if you're not a lover of teal, you won't like this. It's one of those films where they have this sort of veneer of lovely blues and yellows and autumnal colours, but they never deviate from it. The entire film plays out in that entire spectrum. There's no sort of like, we don't cut to like a frosty morgue room where it's different colours. It's all this autumnal zest, veneer. And, well, I liked it, don't get me wrong. But the camera work is great. I was reminded of Dean Cundey on several occasions. Some tracking shots, some terrific pans. But some great transitions. Did I write the editor down? I don't think I did. No, we did not. there are transitions here which are pretty interesting. Almost, if the film was much longer, which of course we'll get on to, it would become a really good trademark and it would herald in the second half even greater things to come. But you've got, for example, in the first half, you have a stapler in the realtor's office where Susan works. Susan's reading a book by Ben Mears. Ben Mears walks in to, I wanted to rent a room for a couple of weeks, and she goes, "You look familiar." And he can tell that she's reading his book, and his picture's on the back of the book, like, very Stephen King style. And she goes, "You look familiar, are you enjoying that book?" She goes, "Well, I'm at the point now where, you know, a female reader decides whether they're going to carry on reading it or not." It's like, okay, yeah. But she realises she made a big gaffe, and like, in it, oh my God, that was him. That's the author himself. Damn it, Susan, you dropped a fucking clanger there. But you transition from a shot of a stapler on her desk or on a shelf or something. The camera goes into it and it dissolves into the exact same format and geometry, but looking down a rectangular staircase, you're looking down, and I thought, that's nice. Later on, Mike Ryerson, the grave digger, played by Spencer Treat Clark, who was, wasn't he Lucius in Gladiator? I think he was. Who we all now know is apparently genuinely Maximus's son, because Gladiator 2 is going to rewrite what we saw in Gladiator. Well, hey-ho for Ridley-o, you know. Can't stop from manipulating and messing about, can you, Sir Ridley? He's the gravedigger and wants one of the burying one of the Glick boys. And it cuts to him and you've got the priest, he opens the Bible and it sees transitions from the pages of the Bible to he opens his peanut butter and jelly. That's jam to us in the UK. Peanut butter and jam. Have you ever in the UK tried that? No, you haven't. It's an American thing. I have. I thought this could never work. It doesn't fucking work. No, it doesn't. It doesn't go at all. Peanut butter and fucking strawberry or raspberry jam doesn't go. What the hell are you thinking? But he opens his butty up and it's sort of like almost like a satanically stained version of the Bible. And I thought that's nice as well. And there's other little transitions like that and great camera work where someone runs one way and then the camera follows them and they come back again and things have changed behind them. A ladder, suddenly they can't get down to the basement of the Marston house because there's no steps there. Oh, crafty that, no steps. Ladder outside. Camera looks down, camera pans around. Next thing, they've gone to get ladder, the camera pans around, and they're all there downstairs. Ladder's been dropped. And it's great, it's seamless, and I like shit like that. Our heroic young lad, Mark Petrie, he's changed race, he's now black in this. Played by Lance Kerwin in the original 1979 version. Brilliantly, Lance Kerwin, who has sadly passed away. Now played by, let's get his name, Jordan Preston Carter, who's a Houdini aficionado, but he's also into his monster movies. Again, but he gets into his treehouse to escape the vampires at one stage, and the camera will move around as they're moving around in the other direction. Shadows going past the wooden panels of the treehouse. And it's great. It's a good one-take shot. Maybe a couple of editing edits in there, but it looks good. So what I'm saying is the film, cinematically, is wonderful to behold. I really was drawn in and bewitched by the visuals. So, the characters, again, well, we know them all. There's a couple of race changes. Dr. Cody's now a black woman, played by... Did I put her down? I didn't put her down, damn it. But she's good as well. And quite foul-mouthed, actually, but... People are dying of anemia, hematoma anemia or something like that. The blood just is not reproducing itself. Why might that be? Could there be a visitor in the night who's putting the bite on and draining blood? And then once they're deaded, they come back. I mean, I'm not going into all the finite things. We know what it is. And Dauberman, who has written this and directed it, he co-wrote the first Stephen King's It Chapter 1. Then he actually wrote the entirety of It Chapter 2. But he was a co-creator and writer on the Conjuring series. And he directed, I think, well, either directed Annabelle, one of the Annabelle movies, or one of the Nun movies, whatever. And then this is his next big movie, which had the ignominy of being put on the shelf by Warners for 2 years. Not good. But, well, I'm not putting any blame at his feet for this. This film has all the hallmarks of having been tampered with. He has said he prepared a three-hour cut. That 3 hours is the length of the Tobe Hooper version and the Rob Lowe, Rutger Hauer version. I forgot who directed it. But 3 hours apiece there. So he made a feature film into 3 hours. And you can see that there probably would have been 3 hours worth of story here, which he was going to tell. And then the studio goes, it's not tested well. Let's snip that. Oh, God. And it's been condensed down by over an hour. Now, everyone goes, before you shout out, like, well, films are always longer than finished cut. Yeah, we know. So there's hours and hours of footage. We're not talking about that. He made a 3 hour cut of the movie. He has said so. And that has not been what has been released. So the version we have now, the first half, actually is slow burn and quite wonderful. I was genuinely surprised by how bewitched and seduced by it I was. The town looked amazing. Again, the colours, the visuals, cinematography soaked me into it. I wasn't too fussed on our main guy, Ben Mears. Lewis Pullman is I know loads of you are like, he's a great actor. Well, I've only seen him in this. And I wouldn't be bandying the word great at all anytime soon. But when he arrives there, and you play the wonderful, Gordon Lightfoot's Sundown. Sundown, and you better take care if you're creeping round my back stairs. That was in the trailer, and I remember remarking at the time, that's brilliant, because the lyrics kind of tie into things happening in the darkness, in the shadows, and it's about sundown, which is hugely important in this. The sun dipping down and shadows creeping across the land, and then the vampires arriving in the shadows. Well, when Ben arrives in town and does a little drive around, which is a great sequence actually, it plays that song, it plays it, and I was like, oh God, it's actually there. They use it. Trailers often use songs and stuff and tracks which are not going to be in the film at all. It's just to set the mood, set the tone. Well, they did it with this and it's actually in the film, and I thought, well, genuinely kudos for that, because it works. Watch that scene again, because there's a certain Plymouth Fury sitting in someone's garage. It's Christine is sat there. There's loads of other Easter eggs, loads. But if you go on certain YouTube channels and other websites, they're going, oh, all the Easter eggs are listed. The vast majority are not Easter eggs. They're just, look, they use monsters, and the horror genre are what's part and parcel of Salem's Lot. So they're not an Easter egg. Just because it's there, it doesn't mean, oh, it's referencing this. It's a fucking trope from a horror movie. But Christine is there. And that other thing, what's it called? Oh, God, I wrote this down somewhere. Moxie Cola. Which is one of the main, you drink it in Maine. It's a Maine residence variant on Coca-Cola. And that's in there as well. The opening title sequence, which is brilliant, by the way, with blood seeping across parchment papers, shipping notes, diaries and maps and letters and things. And it's just, it's brilliantly done. But you'll see within that that there are references to companies that Stephen King has used in various novels, the whole Derry saga and all that. And lots of little references there. That's an Easter egg, that's fine. But it also, is it an Easter egg? Stephen King's books all intertwine. His characters all move between one novel and another. So they've all met and they've all done things. It's a huge magnum opus, really. So these, again, aren't specifically Easter eggs. They are just referencing. It's King's universe that we're in. And I will say this. This film does evoke Stephen King really well. Again, we'll come on to why I think that. Mark Petrie's bedroom. Right, he has his graveyard set up. There's a couple of crucifixes there, very important, they are too. Posters on the wall: Taste the Blood of Dracula, Blackula, Sugar Hill, which is a blaxploitation zombie movie, voodoo zombie movie. You have Dracula AD 1972, you have the British troglodyte movie about a Cro-Magnon, well, a troglodyte prehistoric man on the rampage called Trog. That's there as well. You've got the Aurora Universal Monster model kits are all there as well. But what I didn't add, they were there, but in the 79 version with Lance Kerwin, the camera lingered on these things and showed a hell of a lot more. And you got his passion and understanding and love for horror and the entire genre, the comic books, the models. There was masks as well. Wolfman was there, Lon Chaney Jr. Wolfman. And it's brilliant and it really was evocative. This I was looking forward to and I don't think they did it too well. The stuff's there, but it's not quite as... I wasn't as wowed by it at all. It didn't look like spectacular. Although it was nice to go, Taste a bit of Dracula, Blackula, and Dracula 1972. And the film, of course, is set in 1975. Is it 1975? When the original novel is set, this film is set then. So the fashions, the hairstyles, everything is of that period. And it does come across. Again, that opening sequence where Ben drives through the town, you've got the lad on his bike, chucking the newspapers and all that, what is it about America? You just fucking chuck these things. They could end anyway, someone's gutter, and you're going to come out and find the paper you've bought. That's not good delivery service, that. But I know it's iconic. And so you get to see the people in the streets and all that, and the shops that are there. So when things go tits up in the second half, and it becomes a ghost town, there's a nice transition. Suddenly you see loads of milk bottles outside people's houses. You see all the mail falling out of the mailbox. And you see all these newspapers, several newspapers stacked up across the lawn. It's a nice way of showing that things have gone from normality to apocalyptic, But it's also a bit daft because that kid's still... Well, no one's picked up the newspaper there, but he's still going around and chucking these fucking things. The milkman's still delivering milk and all that, not realising. It's a good visual conceit, though, so I'll give it that. And Christine's there, don't forget Christine. So, Ben and Susan. Susan is played by Mackenzie Lee, and she's god-awful. She's actually wretched. All the other actors do their job reasonably well, but she doesn't. She is the most naive, bizarrely airheaded, meant to be romantic lead, supporting character. And she's garbage. She's a bloody annoyance. And she's under the auspices of her mother, the matriarch of her family, who wanted to get up with Floyd Tibbetts, is it right? But then Ben arrives and, Ben's great. I'm going to get up with Ben and all this. Which, of course, she does. But once kids go missing and the Glick boys have their troubles, And there's a clumsy bit in the first bit. You've got like the two Glick boys escort Mark back to his house because Mark has had an altercation with one of the school bullies. Whilst doing, trying to show up a Houdini trick, how to get out of like rope bonds around his hand, this bully comes over, foul mouth, fat bastard, like they always are, aren't they? Fat fucking layabouts. And he comes over and fucking slugs him. And of course, he wears glasses and gets hit to the deck, but manages to untie himself and like gets the upper hand, gets this cunt on the deck, puts his arm up his back. Like, I'm not sure what he's saying. You call me uncle, call me uncle. This is a racist thing that's going on here, I'm presuming. Call me naive myself. I'm not sure what the hell his argument really was. But he's getting his own back on the bully. And the teacher, what's his fucking name? I didn't write his name down. I don't believe it. But the teacher's really good as well. Jason, but I forgot his name, his real name. He's superb in this, actually. He comes over like once more into the breach because all the other teachers are ignoring a fight taking place. Goes over there and breaks it up. Like, is one of you two going to explain to me, like, who threw the first punch? The bully just storms off, get you later, and all that. Like, and he's been screaming for his life, screaming for his uncle. Nothing more about that. Nothing more. This film sets up a sequence there where you've got, like, right, he's squared off against the bullies and he holds his own. And he tells the Glick brothers, look, you know, you never back down. If I gave in, said sorry, he wouldn't leave me alone for the rest of the year. So you've got to fight back. But next time you come back with all the boys, he said, well, I have to fight then again. You never give in to them. Huge big plot point there, because Mark will not give in to the vampires. But the way they shape this, you think, well, that bully's going to come back. And will he come back as a vampire? Well, no. No, that's never even mentioned again at all. And yet it clearly is a build-up to something forthcoming, and you don't get it. So there's, maybe you did, but it's been cut out. But it's in the full version of the film that we got now, it seems clumsy. And like, well, that just got forgotten about. You were leading somewhere with that, and you went nowhere. So the Glick boys walk him back just to make sure that he's not going to get set upon by this fat bully and his mates. And they go to Mark's house. They see all his models and all that. Like, and there's the big foreshadowed crucifix in his cemetery graveyard diorama. And he's like, oh, don't touch that, says one brother, the Ralph and the Danny Glicks. And like Mark just goes, no, it's fine. The glue's set. It's really rigid. Don't worry about it. Look, it's great. What is all this stuff? Oh, I just love horror movies, blah, 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 blah. And then the two Glick boys go back through the woods on their own. Well, they walk down the road and they get accosted by Mr. Straker. Mr. Straker, who is Barlow, Kurt Barlow, the vampire. His human familiar. The guy that does all his stuff when Kurt Barlow is in his coffin during the daylight hours. Does all his bidding. Played by Pilu... Pilo Asbeek from Overlord and a few other movies. I think he was in The Samaritan with Stallone as well. Pilo Asbeek. And James Mason played Straker in the original. And he was outstanding. He was elegant. He was regal, noble, arrogant, eccentric. Very threatening, very sinister, very debonair. But also hugely threatening, and could pick up a grown man by his shoulders, take him like the rebel commander, about 2-3 feet off the floor, and walk him down a corridor, and then impale him on a wall of antlers. He was a grade A bastard. And this guy, Pilo Asbeek, mustachioed, and the opening scene has him arranging the... Right, you know, there's a last crate arriving, something very special, very historical, very important. I want you to be there at the wharf to meet it at 6 o'clock tonight. here's all the documents, the shipping stuff, and your fee included. You are to take it to the Marston House, open up the cellar doors, take it in there, drag it past. Drag it past, I think it says drag it past the stairs, but there are no fucking stairs in there, and put it here. So you do cut to the next scene of these two. In the book and in the original 79 version, they're driving along and it goes cold in the cab, and the big crate keeps moving towards them down the back, and they're genuinely unnerved. Doesn't do it in this. But what they do, which I liked, they get to the Marston House, and sadly, the only reference you get to the mercenary mafia hitman enforcer that lived there and killed his wife and kids and returned to fucking Satanism is mentioned there. Just a throwaway line. That's it, and that'll be it for the history of the Marston House. But they throw open those cellar doors, and like, right, he goes, like, I'm gonna reverse the truck round so that we be closer to it to get out the back of the truck. So you've got this one guy staring into this abyss of darkness, and then suddenly the whole thing gets suffused with red satanic light, which I thought was a great touch. And one of these, it's the tail lights of the truck coming up, but it suffuses everything with this devilish red tint, and he gets lit up from behind with red. And I thought it looked really good, and they drag this thing down. They don't like it. There's a bit of noise from within it. This Barlow's in there, and they crack it. It cracks open. It's like earth comes up. Why don't you pack it full of earth? Why are these fucking people stupid? Have your head Dracula, you know? Because the priest in this, Father Callahan, is reading Dracula, and they drag it in there. And there's definite movements in there. Like, he says, best not to know. So they get out of there. But it's a good scene, though. I like that scene. And so Barlow obviously makes his presence felt, but Straker catches the Glick boys. He drives up alongside him, and they're walking down the road back from Mark's house, and he's like, do you want a lift, boys? He's got a weird accent as well. Do you want to lift the boys? And they're like, no, yeah, you're all right, we don't like strangers, especially you. Something like that. It's like, okay, boys. And then they're like, come on, Danny, let's get off. Got Danny and Ralph Glick, and they go off into the woods to avoid him, and the camera lingers. It's really predatory and it really nasty, horrible. It gives a very unsettling feeling, as it should do. And he just sits in his car and stares at them, and they've got a harmonica, and it was because one of them's got asthma. So Mark says, look, you can use this to get your breath in order, use the harmonica. So he's got a harmonica now, and the two of them there's an absolutely wonderful shot, sort of black silhouette against a sort of twilight blue sky horizon. And they're going, a bit like the Fellowship of the Ring, going over the mountaintops in silhouette. They're going, traipsing through the trees across this horizon of a hilltop. And as they're walking, another figure is walking behind them. And they hear it, the noise, oh shit. And like, he's been playing a harmonica and all that, like, and suddenly, whilst one walks off, the other figure grabs one of the lads and whisks him off, leaving the other lad, the other brother, on his own. Like, he's going, Ralphie, you know, where are you? Play your harmonica. And he's gone. But we know what's happened. He gets taken back to the Marston House, and he's used as a sacrifice to initiate the new domain. So Barlow has to feast on him. And to be honest with you, he gets thrown down in a hall full of candles everywhere. And then, master, you know, and it isn't that good. It's very Renfield-like, which is not how this should be. Because Straker is his own demonstrative character. He's not just a complete and utter enslaved acolyte. He's clever and conniving of his own. But Pilo Asby does not play him like that. He plays him really shit and wimpish. Master, it's for you, master. Here's your feast. And then the candles all wink out. And then something scuttles about and then arrives. A flash cut of Barlow. And then you just see, you hear, and blood sprays everywhere. A feast. Well, he hasn't fucking eaten him, because Ralphie Glick then comes back as a zombie. Wrong genre. as a vampire, comes for his brother and all that. Well, it's different in this movie. Danny Glick hears the harmonica playing out in the air, the garden, or the yard, as the Americans call it. Fucking plateau of fucking grass and all sorts. They call it a yard. In the UK, a yard, just like a little box of fucking stone walls, bricks and concrete. That's your yard. There's nothing in it. But in America, a yard is like 10 acres. And so he goes out and the harmonica drops in front of him. And it's kind of a creepy scene. Next thing, he's had the bite put on him and the mother takes him into hospital and this septic anemia. I keep getting this fucking thing wrong. But blood been drained and he can't produce his own blood. And he's thirsty. And his mum's screaming like, he's thirsty, get him some water. And they go back, he's got a blood bag there. And they get in there, he's like, and he's bitten through that. And he's like, he's gorged himself on the blood bag. That's quite a horrific scene. He dies. But they don't find the other kid though, the one who went missing, they don't find him. And you've got like it cuts like 1 week later, before Danny dies, 1 week later. And you've got a search party, and Ben's joining the search party. And of course, he struck up a rapport with the teacher. Is it his teacher named Jason or Matt? Oh, God. What's his fucking name? Sorry, I'm looking on the old name now. Jason. It's Jason, isn't it? Jason. And I can't remember the guy's name who plays him. I do apologise about that. I wrote some notes down, but not enough. They've got a rapport going there. And where's it going with that? Oh yeah, and they're in the back of this, you know, this truck. They've come back from a hunt, trying to find Ralph. Is Ralphie there in the mummy tree? Is Ralphie there? And you get the sense of animosity towards Ben, because Ben's an outsider in town, even though he used to live there, but he's an outsider in town, and his arrival, suddenly people are going missing, things are happening. So one of the locals goes like, "Why don't you fuck off back to New York, asshole?" You know? Gives him a bit of a dig on the way past, and you think that would become more of a plot element, his outsider status. No, that's it. It stops right there, like the bully with Mark. That's it. This guy, when you fuck off back to New York, asshole. We don't need you around here. That's it. Forgotten about. And it really is a bit. Are these parts of scenes which were meant to carry on with more sort of denouement and development? Well, not in this version, folks. But you do get like Danny Glick comes back from the grave. Let's get on to Mike Ryerson, played by Spencer Treat Clark, who's the grave digger, played wonderfully by Jeffrey Lewis in the 1979 version. Jeffrey Lewis, who was often the sort of comedic sidekick of Clint Eastwood, although he could play a bad guy. He'd done it in High Plains Drifter, he'd done it in other movies as well, but mainly he was a good guy, a happy-go-lucky sort of guy. He's also in Tango and Cash as well, playing a happy-go-lucky yet hangdog police detective in charge of Stallone and Kurt Russell. That's the most maverick cops the world's ever known. But in Tobe Hooper, Salem's Lot, he becomes one of the things of True Nightmare in the rocking chair with glowing feral yellow eyes. Oh my God, he is genuinely terrifying. Well, this guy, he fell asleep, he opened the butty, the peanut butter and jelly butty, and then he's fallen asleep and it's night time. Oh shit, I've got to fucking do this fucking grave now, this kid in it. And it's quite a well shot sequence, quite suspenseful. You hear knocking on the inside of the coffin. He jumps down and, "I'll get you out of there." What the hell? Opens the coffin and the kid's just lying there dead. Blue. Deaded. Shit. Shuts it down. Goes back for his shovel. Yeah, you guessed it. More noises. What? Oh, hang on. He gets to the open grave. and the casket lid is open and the kid's not there. And he comes flying towards him. So Jason meets him in the local bar. He's at the bar. He's the teacher, don't forget. Like, and he's like, looks over at him. Mike? You all right, Mike? What's happened? And Mike's just sitting there. And it's quite cleverly shot because he's in shadow a lot of the time. And at one point you realise he's actually staring at, well, us, basically. And his eyes are glowing. And he's like, Mike, you need to come tomorrow. Do you want a doctor now? And he moves out the shadow and his eyes return to normal. And I thought that was a nice subtle touch there. And it goes back to Jason's house. Like, Jason, like, go to bed. We'll get the doctor in the morning. But don't you worry about a thing. The power goes out. Noises outside. So Jason goes outside on the porch. And he looks up and he sees a fleeting figure. A ghost-like shadow going to the bedroom window. Runs upstairs. Mike's dead. So he calls the doctor. But who does he call first? I think he calls Ben first. He gets Ben and Susan, because they all think there's something going on. So Ben, Susan, and the doctor, Dr. Cody, all arrive. And she's like, yeah, he's definitely dead. And Jason comes out with one of the most ridiculous early Doors lines ever. He goes, what do you think happened here? Do you think it's the same thing that happened to Danny Glick? And because Danny Glick's mother's died as well now of the same thing. They caught it from one another. And like Dr. Cody said, you can't catch it. It's not contagious. It's in you. You can't just catch it. There's something else at play here. He noticed the marks on the neck of Mike, which have gone now that he's died. The marks have gone. And Jason says something like, I think it's a creature of the night. Fuck off. No, we all know about these things. We all know. We've read the books. We've seen the movies. We love this stuff. If it began to happen in a street near you, your neighbourhood, you're not going to go, it's a creature of the night. You're going to go like, no, it's marks on the neck and they're dead. And people have seen them walking. It's a fucking vampire. It's a vampire. A creature of the night. But what they realise, well, we've got to try and prove this. So they go, well, Mike's body goes to the morgue and then they go and check on the body. Because it's like this, Dr. Cody's going like, this can't be real. You know, they're not vampires, come on. So if he was a vampire, then he won't be in the morgue, will he? So they go the next day, just a sheet. Shit. Well, where'd he go then? Told you, creature of the night. And, I need to see this actually happen. Now, the Glick boy's mother has now died. Well, where's she? Is she in the mortuary? No, the mortuary here. No, no one's, by the guy's name as he runs it, no one's seen him for days because he's been as well. So she's gone out of town. Well, let's go there then and watch what happens when the sun goes down. So they do. And it's a nice creepy scene. It's actually done better in the 1979 version, I'll be honest. But it's still a good scene though. And she's lying there. She's got like little slippers on as well, like, and one falls off. Sorry, I've missed a bit out. Jason's realised that the crucifix works. So you've got to have faith in it. Faith, brother, have faith. Now what this film does, if you've got faith and vampires are near, your crucifix glows bright yellow. I don't like that. It's just, how does it fucking know? Are you joking? What the hell? And it just looks really dizzy. And that they're using it and it going down corridor shadows. And you can put it on. Mark uses the crucifix from his graveyard diorama on Danny Glick's and see it. And it has. And he's gone out the room, out the bedroom window. Because he attacks Mark Petrie and he mesmerizes him. So he opens the windows and he comes floating in. Those scenes of the kids floating outside windows are nowhere near as effective as what Tobe Hooper accomplished with the 1979 version. Nowhere near. But they are there. So if you like that thing, and of course who doesn't, they are there. But they don't work anywhere near as effectively. But we know crucifixes work, but they fucking glow. Anyway, so you've got these guys now, and the mother, they're going like, no, this can't be right. You know, and a shoe falls off, a little slipper falls off, and they all jump around like that. There's Susan there, there's Ben there, and there's Dr. Cody. And then suddenly, you know, things begin to shake, and the shroud begins to come down a little bit, like, and then she sits up. Danny, or Ralphie, she's calling from one of the boys. Where are my boys? Danny, Ralphie, whoever, you know, Ebenezer, are you there? And she sits up in the shroud and turns around and looks at him. And they're like, fucking hell, what are we going to do here? Shit, need a cross. I've got little sort of wooden spatulas, medical things, little tiny sort of nail file shaped splints the doctor has in their bag. Go and get them and make a crucifix out of them. We then get an absolutely ludicrous scene, which is totally cringe and utterly embarrassing. This bitch gets up and starts coming for them, and they're trying to tape together two pieces of wood to make a crucifix, you know, like that. They're trying, there's tape, surgical tape in my bag as well, and they're fighting this thing, and it's just shit, I'm afraid, folks. It's utter bollocks. And it breaks apart. They've got to put it back together again. And they're fighting this thing. And oh, for fuck's sake. They do manage to kill this thing. And I've forgotten how they do it. They do kill it. What did he do? Did he put a stake through it? I can't remember. Folks, I cannot remember how they killed Mrs. Glick. I cannot remember. But crucifixes work if you've got faith. But they glow as well. Steaks. I love a good steak. Rare is best. I'm like Marsha Quist in The Howling. I like my steak rare. Raw, in fact. Now, a lot of staking in this, and I hated it. Once things kick off in the second half, they're staking vampires all the time. There's lots of battles and attacks and jump scares. For some reason, these stakes, you can just go into someone's chest and penetrate. I'm not speaking from vast experience of staking vampires, but you plunge a wooden spiked stave into someone's chest, it ain't gonna go in. They got clothes on. You might break a rib or two, it's not gonna really penetrate. Trust me, it won't. And the great thing about David Soul, who played the original Ben Mears, when he's staking Barlow at the end, it's taking fucking ages. Bang, 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 breath, bang, bang, and Barlow's fighting back, bang, bang. And in the meantime, you've got other vampires creeping brilliantly towards Mark Petrie, who doesn't realise they're there, and they're coming across the floor, eyes glowing, coming towards him. It's brilliant. But it takes about 20 fucking mallet blows. Peter Cushing, Van Helsing, the expert on slaying vampires. He didn't do it with one fucking blow. Courage. You've got to fucking position it and bash that bastard in. It ain't easy. But in this, oh yeah, oh, dead. Roll around, dead. Get plucked up by a flying vampire into the air. And then suddenly you both drop down. But you've stabbed him in midair. It's too easy. It's just, it's fucking shite. And it becomes really, really boring, the amount of staking that takes place. So, the Glick boys are dead. Oh, well, yeah, well, whatever. Fucking hell, whatever. It all goes helter-skelter into the second half, where the town's decimated. No one's around. Barlow. Alexander Ward plays Barlow. People denied this for weeks. I knew it was him playing it because I'd see his Instagram stuff and I knew. So I said it on this channel. I went, a fella called Alexander Ward who plays creatures and who look, I thought this is good because He looks like Reggie Nolder. Well, Reggie Nolder had horrific disfigurement. Like the Joker in The Dark Knight, you know, oh no, I got these scars. He never tells the same story twice. Reggie Nolder never told the same story twice about how he got the facial disfigurement. But he's a very lean, tall guy, but his face sank in, his cheeks were bowled inwards. Like Peter Cushing, very gaunt. You can put makeup on a face like that, and you can rip it into it, and you know. But he looked iconic. Well, you can see him. You can see him here. He's here, there, and everywhere. Barely see that in the darkness, but Alexander Ward, in reality, has a face like that, just without the scars, pointy nose, and a sunken face, sunken cheeks. So we were all awaiting: is he going to be Barlow? Won't be a mask or a CGI thing. There were rumours saying it was going to be CG, replacing it with the old look of Reggie Nolder. No. Alexander Ward wears the makeup, and the makeup's pretty damn good. It's not a dime store cheap ass mask, as some people who saw early screenings were saying. No, it looks good. The bits of it kind of glow as well. There's elements where you see him in close up, and there's little chinks of light inside, and he's kind of this colour here on the mask here, but little sort of flaming elements sort of leap through, like infernal blood corpuscles or something like that, but you barely ever see him. That's the other thing. He will just, like in the Tobe Hooper version with Reggie Nolder, there's lots of, suddenly he's there, and you go, fucking hell. Like in The Cell Block, you don't get it in this movie. The Cell Block, you're fucking hell, Jesus. They are jump scares that are eternal. They never, never lose their capacity to shock you and jolt you. This movie has jump scares piled upon jump scares, and every single one of them falls flat. Every single one. The build-up is great to some of these, but the actual payoff is crap and lackluster, time and time again. And he will leap, not just him, but all the vampires will leap out the shadows and put the bite on someone's neck. So you're going to lose some major characters throughout the early part of the second half, and they'll be transformed. And there, I'm not going to go into all the fucking details. Got into enough already. But Barlow, in the book, he looks normal. Well, tall and a bit sinister, but he's not fucking Nosferatu. He's not, and he can talk. He's erudite. He's urbane. He's sophisticated. He's articulate. And in this, unlike Reggie Nolder, he can talk. Rutger Hauer's version was human looking, and could talk, which is a great sort of path back to the book. But it just wasn't very threatening at all. This guy looks like Reggie Nolder, and he does talk. There is a moment, like in Mark Petrie's house, where his mum and dad, you know, and, well, originally Straker goes in there, your faith against his faith, you against the master, bow down before the master, back priest, back shaman, you know, and all this kind of shit, like, have you got any faith, priest? And Barlow bangs the mother and dad's heads together, killing them both. Kills the priest and all that, like, and Mark, I'm gonna kill you, you know. Well, you get that in this, and it's fucking bollocks. He just basically arrives, dad, look, I'm sick of this vampire talk, mum and dad. First time you met them, in fact, and you know, I'm sick of this vampire talk. No, this is ridiculous, I don't believe a word of it. And the priest is there, they've got the priest on the side now. The priest is sitting in a chair reading Dracula. He was like, he's a lapsed priest as well. Hit the bottle, don't they all, you know? And he's like, you know, reading Dracula and all, you know, you say this is all true, you know, I spent my life defending God and like fighting evil like this, you know, but you're saying it's here in our town now. Oh, before you say, like, what about William Sadler? Yeah, Parkins Gillespie, Constable Parkins Gillespie. Well, William Sadler is in this and doesn't do fuck all, you know, he doesn't. But then again, Parkins Gillespie doesn't do much in the book. He's counting, you know, the minutes down to retirement. I don't want any work to do. And he fucks off, you know, once he knows the shit's hit the fan. And it's quite a good little speech he has. He says, like, you wonder why you picked here. Salem's Lot is dead anyway. Everyone's dead. There's nothing here. It's been a dead town for years. That's why he picked this place. You know, and I'm getting out of here. Off he goes. You're the only lord in town. You're meant to look after us. Oh, bye. Oh, ta-da. And Christine goes after him. No, doesn't. But the priest, yeah. Well, he gets offed as well. So the dad gets bitten off camera. And then the mum gets... But does the mum get bitten as well? I think she does. I can't remember now. And the priest gets his crucifix out. And it glows like a crucifix lightsaber. And then... But Barlow speaks to him then. It's like, how sad when a man of faith loses his faith. So he speaks because the cross loses its light, and then the priest gets getting killed as well. Like, so Barlow speaks, but he says that line, and he says something later on. What is the fucking point of having... You've got the best of all worlds. You've got a Barlow that looks like Reginald and Nosferatu. And he can speak like he does in the book. He can taunt. He can, you know, have a conversation with his enemies and belittle them. But that's it. You get fucked, you know. So sad when a man loses his faith. You're meant to be this fucking prime intelligence. You've existed for centuries, aeons. In the book, he's fought enemies older than the Catholic Church. So he's been around for a hell of a long time. He's infernal. You don't get any of that shit in this. No, doesn't come into it at all. A couple of... That line there. And then at the end, he might say something like, come to me or something. You're mine. Bitch. He says something else. But what is the bloody point of having him being able to speak if you're not going to have a conversation? It just looks and sounds ridiculous. I want to see him. Those who have seen him sit down and have, literally, you know, okay, I can't get you right now because we're on sacred ground, but I'm coming for you. This would be a nice change. I'm coming for you, your family, your auntie, sister's cousin in Oxnard, you know. You've got family in Scotland. Oh, I'm coming for you, boy. You know, boyo, that's fucking Welsh. But you know what I mean? Would it be nice to, if you're going to make him do it, then make him do it properly. There's a couple of sinister, growly, slithery one-liners. Shit. Tropism and crap. But Mark gets away, gets loads of steaks, gets some holy water, and honestly. They go to the Marsden House. This is before some of them have died. They go to the Marsden House because... Mark gets captured by Straker and hung upside down. But of course, foreshadowing, Mark has learned the tricks of Houdini. So he manages to get out of that. And then he kills Straker. He hits him with something, I can't remember what it is now, something big and metal, in the face. Fuck off! But he just goes, ugh! Hits the deck, and he hits him again in the head, and blood goes, shh! And Straker's gone. Pilu Asbeek as Straker. A few scenes early on, then nothing. Nothing. Waste. James Mason was excellent. This guy is fucking pants. Absolute pants as the character. Unthreatening and nothing and nobody. Why the hell would Barlow use him? Fucking useless. But Barlow moves on to someone else. Susan's mummy. And Susan becomes Carrie White's mother. Overzealous and like, oh, I met this new man he's so bewitching, and I love what he wants to do. I've joined him heart and soul. He's totally bewitched and, you know, smitten by him under his mesmerizing spell. But she'll have to fucking big 12 gauge shotgun. And she's like, fucking hell, what's her name in Misery? You know, Kathy Bates' character. Carrie White's mum and Kathy Bates into one. And she becomes the next sort of minion of Barlow. Right. Susan gets fucking done. The priest is done. Teacher's done. And Ben should have been done, but he hasn't. He comes out, he gets picked up, but manages to mid-air stake and drops to the deck, which should have broke his back, but anyway. And then it's the next day. They could have stayed in church. Oh, that's right. What about Parkins Gillespie? Where is he? In the trailer, there was a great shot of something smashing through a stained glass window, which we all thought was a vampire, possibly even Barlow. No. What happens to him? It's Parkins Gillespie gets hailed through the window, lands there. Well, that's what happens to him. He's dead, like everybody else. At the end, you've only got Mark and you've got Ben. That is it. Mark has killed Danny Glick. He staked him as well. And sorry, my dog is making noises here. Like you're not hungry. You've eaten loads. So hold yourself in order, please. It's that fucking plenty. Which he has. And so Ben and Mark. Well, hang on. Susan has now become a vampire, by the way. And but it's everyone. There's no one in town. It's daylight. No one in town. You know, there's someone else that's missing. Where are all the cars? And this is the big Stephen King thing, which is not in the book. Susan and Ben, their first date was at the drive-in, the local drive-in. And they're watching thrillers. There's no horror. Strangely, it wasn't horror movies. It was two thrillers that they were playing. I forgot what they were now. Real movies. And but that's when they got their first, you know, feelings for each other. But now she's a vampire, so hey-ho, you know, so much for that. And where's all the cars? Where'd all the cars go? Where do you find lots of cars? Because they're trying to find where the vampires are sleeping. At the drive-in. So they go off to the drive-in, there's all the cars, and open up the boot. And there they're all the vampires are all sleeping in the boots of the cars. And of course, the first one, he goes to her car on purpose, like, but there's Susan. Kill her now. And then the mother comes out with a fucking 12 gauge. Bang, bang, fuck. So you get this big, overblown, overwrought, and overlong finale of Mark and Ben being chased around all the parked cars, vampires coming out of them, and the sunlight. You've got the big screen, the massive screen where the film, the driving movie would be projected onto. The sun's dipping behind that. Think I Am Legend. And like, oh my God, the shadows are creeping. And like, you know, and like, I'm hanging upside down here, and like, my dog's safe at the moment, but they've got zombie dogs and dark seekers. And once the shadow goes over, they can come and get me. It's exactly the same as that. Exactly the same. And it's crap. So they start, once they're in shadow, they can come out and like they're attacking him and he's fighting them and bang, bang, bang. And they're trying to staking loads. Mark, just run. Mark, who's 11 years old, fashioned stakes and holy water and battled all these fucking vampires and come up with ideas all the time. 11 years old, folks. He's like a fucking 18. He is Hannibal. And fucking B.A. Baracus hotwires a car and he drives it through the struts holding up the big projection screen, knocking all these logs down. And so it goes and it fucking lands on all these fucking vampires like that, crushes all the cars, crushes half of them. Of course, Ben manages to get away, gets into the fucking the main office is, the drive-in. And Susan attacks him. He has a battle royale with Susan, rattling around his place, going over tables, and she's throwing him around. And of course, he manages to kill her. But Barlow makes an appearance in one, probably the only striking shot of him. He's on top of the hoarding of the drive-in, silhouetted, you know, with his. I don't even know what he wears. That's the other thing. I don't know what he's wearing. Is he wearing like a long cape? Has he got some regal gown on? Fucking no, you don't see it. And he's on top of this thing. It might do some swoopy flybys. Again, you don't see him do that. It's just the camera flying over people's heads. And he's going after Mark. And Mark's now underneath this hoarding, this the collapsed screen. So like Ripley and Newt in Aliens, and the Queen putting her hands through, he's doing that. I'm sure he says something like, come here, boy, or something like that. And he... Ben will destroy Susan. And then finally, shut up, dog, will you please? Mark's caught underneath, the hand comes down, and they got Barlow's face, like that. Pulling up like that, and next thing, a stake comes through Barlow's head, back of his head, comes through his mouth. Shut up, will you? And gets taken out. And in a crafty little shot, a bit of a CG shot, obviously, you've got the hole, you're seeing Mark's looking up through the air, the hole in Barlow's throat, back of his throat, back of his neck, and there's Ben there. And Barlow's gone. The two of these have survived. They get in the car. What do we do now? And like Ben just goes, like, guess one of his Mark's top trump fucking magician cards. We'll do like he does. We'll make our escape. Houdini. And that's it. Off they drive to that song, Sundown Again. And that's it. First half, slow build up, but enough character to get to know and be concerned about what happens in the set pieces. The set pieces that we all know and love are there. Then he adds a load of new stuff which you don't need. Barlow is on screen for about 2 minutes. I'm not saying that Reggie Nolder is on screen for a 3-hour movie for a great deal longer, but it has more impact. He has more to give, and more, he's more threatening and doesn't even speak. But he's holding, like, you know, the mum and dad. And he's fucking amazing. The cell block, every single sequence, even when he's getting staked at the end by Ben, poof, poof, and he's like, you're still terrified of him. This guy you're not scared of in the least. Alexander Ward does fuck all. Just a couple of, like, leaning out of the shadows, and that's it. Whoosh. Big fat wow. Absolute fucking lackluster disappointment. Big letdown, you wuss bag. Longer version, I don't know. Is there more stuff in it? Who the hell knows? Will we ever find out? Who the hell knows? But did I enjoy this movie? I enjoyed half of it and then really felt let down and disappointed by the end of it. It didn't work. It doesn't hold together. A lot of people are saying, oh, it's just entertaining. Yeah, it is. But shouldn't we be expecting something more? A Salem's Lot adaptation which just does a rote by the numbers. You know, greatest hits of the original, with a few more bits of the story, digital story thrown in, and then its own thing thrown in. But it should have done a lot more. It should have been more exciting. Lewis Pullman is crap. He has no personality whatsoever. He's absolutely the Billy Bland of Blandsville, Bland County. What's her name? Lee, Mackenzie Lee is god awful. She is a wretched bloody actress. This is a terrible performance. The other, most of the people, even Mark, what's his name? Jordan Preston Carter. It's pretty good. With a one-note character, you don't get to know his dynamic with his family. You don't get to know anything about that. Oh, I'm into monsters and magicians. That's it. That's fucking all you need, I suppose. But he is... Where did he learn all these skills? How's a hot-wire a car? You know, he's a take-charge kind of guy, but how did he get to be like that? Someone like that, Ben Mears, who loses his parents at the age of 9 in a horrific car accident, and then has to go and live with extended family and fend for himself, I suppose. That's the sort of guy who should be really in charge. I can deal with anything. I've been through hell, you know, and more besides. This is nothing to me. That's the kind of character that Mark should have had that backstory, but that's not how it happens. And the score, as I say, is great divorce from the movie. I got the score, it dropped at midnight the day the film came out, and I got it from Amazon. Listened to it a couple of times, I thought, this is good, I like this. In the movie itself, apart from the bits which emulate Rocky Banos' Evil Dead score, it's just not there. I can't remember any scene where the score played a part in it. It will be, but I listened actively to scores and it did nothing for me. I just didn't recognise it in anything at all. Visually it's great, but it's very samey. That teal look, that the autumnal colours. I will say, for Halloween, in the run-up to Halloween, it's actually pretty... It's effective in that. It's a lightweight vampire action horror movie. It's not controversial. It's not going to rock you well. It's not going to blow you away. But it's a diversion, which is nice enough. But it does look Halloween-y. It does have that sort of vibe to it. And that is a huge plus point. Folks. Salem's Lot. Gary Dauberman. There's some little notes. Great final shot, one take. What was that? Great final shot in one take. What was the final shot? Can't remember. What else was there? Oh, God, I know. Oh, that was from the trailer, where they go into the church. Oh, this is another stupid thing. So, what you noticed? There's no one around. What else is missing? All the cars. Where are all the cars going to be? Well, tell you what, why don't we just stay in the church until the sun rises and we've got a full day to go out there and stake them all? Why don't we just do that? No, you wait till the end of the day. Let's do it now. When the sun's going to go down, why would you fucking do that, you moron? What a fucking dipshit fucking tactic that is. They're going to be rising, you idiot. Stay in the church where you're safe throughout the night and then sun up. Whoa, go and get him then. David Soul, of course, played Ben Mears in the original version. And David Soul did that terrific thing, Starsky Notch, where he leaps on the roof of the car and sinks it in like that. Both David Soul and Paul Mark Glazer, so Hutch and Starsky and Hutch, do fantastic sort of slides across the bonnet of the Gran Torino or other vehicles. Now in this, now David Soul ain't here, of course, but Ben Mears, Lewis Pullman, does do in a slow-mo an arse slide across the hood of a car in the driving. It slides across it, and I thought, that has got to be an homage to Hutch and Starsky Hutch. It's got to be! Because they really showboat it. It's this big slide, and the vampires are coming for him and all that. By the way, when he's got about 10, 15 vampires on him and surrounding him as well, I'm afraid, buddy boy, they'd have put the bite on you. The film ends where they've defeated them all. There's no twist ending. There's nothing after the credits. There's no twist to say, oh, but one survived. No. You don't get that at all. In the book, Mark joins the church. He's accepted into the church. And Ben, they go back to Salem's Lot to kill more vampires every year. And at the end of it, Ben decides, like, look, this is too big, so I'm going to burn the entire town down. And that's what he sets out to do, burn the town down. In the 79 version, Ben and Mark, they have a bookend, a prologue and an epilogue in church. The contagion of vampirism has spread elsewhere. There's other vampires to slay, so their mission is ongoing. A bit like Phantasm, in fact, very similar to Phantasm. Their mission is ongoing. But in this, they just, well, what do we do? Magician's card, Houdini, let's make our escape. And like, what? How are you going to explain what happened here? Where are you going to go? It's just up in the air. There's no like hint of like, well, there's more to do. There's other vampires out there. Some have got away. There's nothing like that at all, which is a big mistake as well. Mistake. God. Now, again, folks, in the UK, a lot of you haven't seen it. A lot of you won't do what I did. And I understand that perfectly. That's totally fine. Me, I've got an obligation to review it. If I can't be shown it straight away, like it should have been done. But I'll find it elsewhere. This was never offered as a press screening to me. I get some films offered as advanced screenings and press screenings. This never cropped up at all. So I went out of my way to do it. Well, I just found a certain platform which allowed me to see it in HD and glorious sound quality as well. But dodgy as fuck, you know? But there you go. Would I go and see it at the Flicks in a week's time? Less than a week's time? No, I wouldn't. No. The film will look... If you're going to wait until you watch it at the Flicks in the UK without doing illicit streamings or whatever, then visually, I think you're going to be in for a treat. It does look cinematic. As far as some reviewers are going, like, oh, you can tell this always should have been streaming. It's very flat. It's not flat at all. It does look cinematic. It looks pretty damn good, to be honest. The visuals are great. Cinematography is outstanding. I thought it looked all right. So cinematically, it could be a bit of a boon. But I will not go and see it again. I will not buy it on 4K Blu-ray. I will not bother watching it again. It's limp-wristed. It's lackluster. It's bloodless. It's fucking blood. Yeah, there's a bit of blood. But no way is this gory. It's not at all. Violence-wise, 79, the TV movie was more shocking, what happened in that, than what you see in this. But anyway, Salem's Lot, 2024, originally 2022, but on the shelf, from Guy Dauberman, is entertaining, bit of vampire fluff, nothing more. Great, interesting first half. Completely lackluster and just Law of Diminishing Returns, second half, where it just gets stupid and stupid and even stupider again. But there you go. Vampires. They are amongst us, you know. Especially in Maine and Salem's Lot. They filmed it in Massachusetts, by the way. But yeah, I don't think you're going to really know that. I don't live around there, so I don't live in Maine or Massachusetts. It looked good to me. Folks, the Stephen King thing. Stephen King loves drive-ins, and they feature in a lot of his books as well. So I like the way that was brought in. And I do like that. It just, I don't like the way it was done and the way it was protracted and became really fucking stupid. But I like the way it played a part in this. Sorry, I meant to say that a bit earlier, but you know what I'm like. Anyway, here's to Sugar Hill and Trog and Taste the Blood of Dracula and Dracula AD 1972 and of course Blackula, Mark Petrie's collection. So this film, ugh, mark out of 10. Oh, why did I do that? I don't do this normally. Mark out of 10, 5.5 out of 10. First half is good. So there's 5, that's halfway. So just over. 5.5, 6 if I'm feeling... No, I'm not. No. 5.5 out of 10. Pick the vampire nibbled bones out of that. Folks, I have been always shall be killed, man. Please, in the meantime, in this ever... Oh, God, will you stop remaking stuff and sanitising them and watering them down in between time? Please keep it kilted, keep it kilted. I'm going to see you all. And if a couple of eccentric guys move into your town and open an antiques boutique, be afraid. Be very afraid. But if they're played by Alexander Ward and Pilu Asbeek, don't worry, because they're a bit shit.